Hi, my name's Pranav and you're watching Science is Dope. Over the past few days, this clip that talks about the scientific merits of the Shiv Ling has been spreading all over social media, being shared widely by tons of believers who are boasting on about how their beliefs are based in science. I must add right now, for those of you that have clicked on this video to see if I'm hurting any religious sentiments, that is not what this video intends to do. I'm simply going to look at where this claim comes from and examine the science behind it, if any. I've already spoken out against this video, but the video I made was a little too short and I think it deserves a longer video. And that's what this video is. Now, the first thing that came to my mind when I heard this claim that Shiv Ling is a source of radioactivity is, that sounds very familiar. Where have I heard this before? This is the Da Vinci Code, a 2003 New York Times bestseller by Dan Brown, in which he uses certain elements from Christianity to create a thrilling and nail-biting murder mystery that takes place in a modern era. We also see a similar mythological theme in Rick Riordan's Percy Jackson series, which revolves around a teenage boy from the modern era who realizes that he is the son of the Greek god Poseidon. There are many such stories from popular fiction that have drawn inspiration from mythology to create these parallels between the mythological world and the modern world to drive their plot points. The same goes for Hindu mythology. It's a gold mine of amazing storylines and has become the foundation for many great novels. For example, we have the gripping Ramchandra series by Amish Tripathi, or the retelling of the Mahabharata from Draupadi's point of view in The Palace of Illusions by Chitra Banerjee Devakarni. One such work is Ashwin Sanghi's The Krishna Key. Spoiler alert for people who are planning to read it, the story goes back and forth between post-Mahabharata mythology and the current era, where a history professor gets falsely accused of a murder. And in his journey of proving himself innocent, he uses writings from Indian mythology as clues to uncover the lost treasures of Lord Krishna and find the actual killer. The reason I'm bringing up the Krishna Key is this book is where I first came across this connection. There's a scene in the story where the protagonist, Professor Saini, takes a map of India and marks the 12 areas of highest radiation levels. And these locations also happen to be the home to the 12 Jyotirlingas, which could, according to the story, only mean that the Shivlings are a source of nuclear radiation. Quite a fascinating plot point, isn't it? I thought so too, and I didn't think of it much more back then because it's a fictional story and the author makes it clear in the disclaimer. But apparently some people have taken ideas like these way too seriously. Let's look at what some of these posts are trying to establish. This here is a typical example of one such post. Starts off by claiming that if you pick up any radioactivity map of India, you'll find that the Jyotirlinga shrines are located exactly in the areas of highest radioactivity. So let's do that. Here we have a terrestrial or natural background radiation map of India, and I got it from a government website, the Atomic Energy Regulatory Body of India, and we also have a map of all the Jyotirlinga locations for comparison. Look at this radiation map. The color scale, or the height of the different peaks, indicate the areas of highest and lowest radiation levels. The sharp green peaks are the areas having the highest natural radiation levels, and the flat purple plains are the areas of lowest natural radiation levels. And these additional red dots are the locations of the artificial nuclear reactors shown in this map. Interestingly, some of these nuclear reactors, like the Bhabha Atomic Research Center, are in the regions of lowest natural radioactivity. Now, if we compare these two maps and try to see where the Jyotirlinga shrines are located, we see that only Omkareshwar, Kedarnath and Baidyanath lie in the green regions, but the rest of them, they lie either in the purple or the blue areas, which are relatively lower natural radiation. So this fails to prove that Shivlings and natural radioactivity are connected. Then there are claims that Shivlings themselves are radioactive. We'll come to that soon, but first I wanted to cover the most mathematically pleasing section of this post. The distance between Mahakaleshwar in Ujjain and the remaining Jyotirlingas. This is what they claim the distances are, and this is what the actual distances are. You should also wonder to yourself how the numbers can be so precise in kilometers when there's nothing special about the kilometer at all. It's just an arbitrary unit of a distance from the French SI system and has nothing to do with India. They also say that Ujjain is considered to be the center of the earth. Okay, it's not, because the center of the earth is inside the earth, but okay, fine. Let's say they mean the geographical center of the earth. But even then, that's wrong, because Ujjain is 7,000 something kilometers from the North Pole and 12,000 something kilometers from the South Pole. So how can that mean it's the center of the earth? Not just this post, but there are many posts on social media that claim similar or maybe even the exact same thing. But where are they getting this highly specific information from? I searched above and beyond and could not find a legitimate source for this information until I saw this tweet, which says, famous historian late P.N. Oak described 12 molecular NFE centers of ancient India in chapter 21 of the first block of his famous book Vaidik Vishwa Rashtraka Itihas. In fact, this same typo, NFE centers, is there in all such posts, showing that it came from the same source, probably copy-pasted by the same person. But that doesn't matter. The real question is, who is this P.N. Oak? Remember this claim that Taj Mahal is actually a Hindu temple called Tejo Mahalaya, and how these news channels were debating this topic a couple of weeks back?
Taj Mahal Magbara hai ya Shiv Mandir Tejo Mahalaya?
Taj Mahal ko Tejo Mahalaya batane wale tamam tar.
Do you know where this claim comes from? The late P.N. Oak. The Tejo Mahalaya claim has been debunked thoroughly previously, so I'm not gonna talk in detail about it, but I am gonna talk about P.N. Oak. He was not a historian at all. He was a conspiracy theorist who made up claims like Christianity actually originated in India, and it comes from the term Krishna Neeti, and the Catholic Church's Vatican actually comes from the Sanskrit term Vatika, and how Delhi's Red Fort is actually Hindu Lal Kot. You can check out the titles of the books he's written to see how ridiculous his claims are. And he's claiming all of this without any evidence. The things he has said are, however, very popular with Hindu nationalists, because he's saying the things that they want to be true. And they think, hey, this guy's a historian, so what he's saying must be true. He is not a historian, because history is not a list of statements that you want to be true. It's a list of statements that are true based on the best interpretation of evidence. This evidence could be in the form of verified written records, oral traditions, ancient art, engravings, or geographical and archaeological findings. You can't just make up stories based on minute similarities between names of things or random shapes and call them facts of history. Remember, extraordinary claims require extraordinary evidence. But P.N. Oak doesn't seem to understand this, because he looked at the Bhabha Atomic Center's nuclear reactor and thought to himself, hey, that looks like a Shivling. I should probably write this in a book. And so he did. And this book, World Vedic Heritage, A History of Histories, was the origin of this claim that associates Shivling with radioactivity. That's where people like Shubhankar Mishra gets these ideas from, and they make videos like these that go viral. Now, the first part of this video, if you leave out the, what about those religions? They do wasteful practices too. What about them? If we leave that part out, then he does make a valid argument. Hey, it's my money and I'm gonna do what I like with it. You can judge him for saying that, you can criticize him, but you cannot argue against him for saying that. But that is not where it ends. He had to give a scientific justification for his belief. For his belief that he probably already had and only later came across this seemingly scientific justification. He had to be like, oh, Shivlings are found in areas that contain radioactive elements, and milk, datro and bay leaf absorb radiation? If you understand what radioactivity is, then you'll see how ridiculous this statement is. What makes something radioactive? A radioactive element has a heavy atom, and because it's heavy, it's unstable. What makes it heavy is having a lot of protons and neutrons in the nucleus. This heavy nucleus wants to split into smaller nuclei which are more stable, and this is what we call a nuclear reaction. During a nuclear reaction, a lot of energy is released as alpha, beta, and gamma radiations. If you look at the periodic table, the elements marked in yellow are radioactive, and the rest have a stable atom, meaning they're non-radioactive. And of these radioactive elements, the heaviest ones that are naturally found are uranium and thorium. Areas where we have deposits of these elements close to the surface tend to be high in alpha, beta, and gamma radiations, and therefore natural radioactivity. So for ShivLings to be radioactive, they must be made of these elements, and a simple chemical analysis of readings from a Geiger counter, which is an instrument for measuring radioactivity, will tell you that, whether that's true or not. But such analyses of facts never come along to support the fact. ShivLings, correct me if I'm wrong, are made of stone, not uranium. So how can they be radioactive? As I always say in this channel, extraordinary claims require extraordinary evidence. He also says milk, datra and belpatra are offered to a ShivLing because these have the ability to absorb radiation. Well, not according to science, at least. Milk can have trace amounts of radioactive substances like iodine-131, but such things usually find their way into the milk because the grass the cows eat have traces of iodine-131, and not because milk has any ability to absorb radiation from its surroundings. Also, there is no evidence that datra or bay leaf can soak up radiation like Mr. Mishra claims. And extraordinary claims require extraordinary evidence. You can say that your mom is the best in the world, and you don't have to provide any justification for that, and nobody is going to argue with you or say that you're wrong. It's the same with personal beliefs. You can say your religion is the best in the world and nobody is going to argue with you. But it's when you try to justify your beliefs with scientific facts, all of which can so easily be shown to be wrong, that you run the risk of embarrassing yourself like Mr. Mishra just did. Another thing is that the art and the literature that are based on Hindu mythology are beautiful works of fiction. The way the authors draw parallels between what was written long back with the modern world or modern science makes these works really interesting to read. Even the plot lines of the mythological stories themselves are really amazing and captivating. But it's when you start taking them seriously and start thinking that, hey, this is all real and these are all facts of history, that these works kind of lose their beauty, and the people who say such things lose any chance of ever being taken seriously by people who don't already share their beliefs. The last thing is that by saying things like this, you're hurting the people who do trust you and listen to you. You're giving everyone the wrong idea of science. You're making them think that science is this Western invention made to go against their culture. And this creates an aversion towards science in them that only affects them. That'll affect the choices they make, what kind of medicines they choose to put in their bodies, what kind of jobs they choose to get, what kind of things they choose to study. It only affects them, right? Science is just a way of looking at the world and figuring out what's true using evidence. It has nothing to do with any part of the world it supposedly originated from. This is a criticism that I often get, usually accompanied by some hateful remarks from the people who hate the fact that I only take elements from their religion to make a video on. And they say, if you're a true atheist, you would make content on other religions too. Otherwise, you're just anti-Hindu. First, I've already addressed this in a previous video. But I understand how new audiences discover my channel every day and they might not have seen this video. So I might have to repeat some points here. Sure. Second, I have made videos on ideas from other religions too. You can find them on my channel. And I plan to make more of them in the future. Three, if you really want to see criticisms of Islam and Christianity, then check out GM Skeptic or Rationality Rules or my friend's channel Pakistani Mulhid. These are some wonderful ex-Muslims and ex-Christians that make really good content, and I'll link their channels below. Four, this criticism is like going to an ex-Christian like Drew McCoy of the channel GM Skeptic and saying, why are you not making content on Hinduism? Are you a true atheist or just an anti-Christian? Can you try and guess why he's not making content on Hinduism? Five, there is a lot of bullshit in other religions too, but pointing those out is not gonna do anything to clean up your religion, right? Please stop asking stupid questions like, what about them? Is their flying donkey scientific? Last but probably the most important point of all these, I don't look at which religion an idea comes from, but rather how popular the idea is and whether it uses science to justify itself. Someone sent me a Twitter video the other day which had a Muslim mullah speaking about something and it had 100 views or something, and he asked me to make a video on it. Why would I make a video on it? To get a few hundred views, to make all you haters happy? Even this video I did not because the topic is on Hinduism, but it's something popular on social media and is a gross misrepresentation of science, and some people are taking it seriously. And if I have some agenda against a religion, then why would I waste my time making all these videos that are not religious at all? Videos on alternative medicine, on spirituality? I'll tell you why. Look at what's common among all of them, pseudoscience. And when I make videos on such topics, my only aim is to help people think rationally about such things. That's what I want to say. I'll see you in the next one. Till then, remember, science is dope.